Hey, my name is Bob Harris. I'm excited to be here tonight to get to talk about this topic. I do have to just address the elephant in the room and just get out of the way right now. I am a Chiefs fan. Who's a Chiefs fan? Who's a Chiefs fan? Absolutely. This was a huge year. Waited my whole life, literally, for this, as long as everyone else in the room has too. But I tell you what, it was fun. This was me with my kids, three of the five. All sitting there, got the snacks, we're getting ready for the game. This is pregame, and we had a blast. The boys loved watching it. They got their, like, you know, sparkly bubbly water and nacho cheese. Nacho cheese is a thing at our house right now. You can't watch football without nachos and cheese, so that's pretty exciting. My two-year-old, she's not in the picture, she loves jalapenos. Go figure. She's pretty spicy herself, and so it kind of isn't too surprising. But, man, I love football. I love the Chiefs. I love that they're Super Bowl champions. I love football. I think it literally is the best team sport ever. The best team sport ever. And so some of you may disagree with that. If I got some others in mind, that's fine. But I cannot think, literally, of another activity, another sport, another game. We have that many different kinds of humans, of large, large animal-type humans and small, like kicker-type humans, and they all have to work together, even with their coaches, to make it all happen. It is an amazing thing to watch a football team excel at the highest level, and so what we've seen this postseason with the Chiefs is really something special. I love football. I love teams. God actually has a lot to say about teams in the Bible, and so it's exciting tonight for us to think about this topic as we continue thinking through getting a 2020 vision for our growth, our spiritual growth. What's it look like to grow in our faith and shift the topic really to something similar to team, and that's to how do we grow with others? What does this really look like to grow with others? That's what we're going to focus on tonight. You get to hear from me. You're going to talk to one another, but I think we're going to come away with some great stuff from it. Here's the deal. God's got a lot to say about it. There's some very general principles that we could even start off with. I love Proverbs 18:1. It says, "He who separates himself seeks his own desire. He quarrels against all sound wisdom." Just a basic biblical principle here, a life principle here. It's not good to be alone. Not good to go through life alone. So don't do it. Find people to do it with. Proverbs 13:20 says, "The one who walks with the wise will become wise, but a companion of fools will suffer harm." The Bible's really clear that God wants us to know that we have to be careful if we're going to go through life not alone, but with other people. Let's be really careful then who we choose to put around us as we go through life. See, your friends are going to influence you either for better or for worse. The Bible's really clear about that. But I've got one more even here at Proverbs 27:17. It says, "As iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another." Just a great reality that, you know, the closest relationships we have are going to be the ones that shape us the most. So we have to be really careful who we choose to put close to us, because there's going to be friction, there's going to be sparks, there's going to be energy and heat that's released, and it's going to shape us and hopefully sharpen us and make us better. The Bible's really clear about all of these things. And I love it just that it is. This is a great place to begin to keep these general principles in mind. But if we're really going to think about what it looks like to grow in our faith, what it's going to look like to grow in Christian faith and our spiritual relationship with God, I think we have to start a little bit further back. Yeah, there's some general principles. You know what? The ones that we just read that I think, you know what? If someone was Jewish here, they'd be able to agree with them. If someone was Muslim, they'd probably be able to agree with what we just read and saw. If they're a Mormon, or there would probably be some atheists that would be like, you know, from life experience, I see every one of those principles you just laid out being true. See, God has something more for us than just general team principles when it comes to our spiritual life. And if we're going to really grow with others in our faith in Jesus, we really have to go back to the very beginning and start with Him, because our view of God will determine how we view others and how we view growth. Let's look at God's story. Let's begin there. We can sum it up with these four words: creation, fall, redemption, and restoration. You see, in the very beginning, we go to the very beginning pages of the Bible, the very beginning of time, God created people. He created Adam and Eve, male and female, and he created them in his perfect image. They were to be just like him. And being just like him, they would have perfect relationships with him, just like he had always had perfect relationship with himself. Before he was beginning to build the world and make the world, he had a perfect relationship, Father, Son, Spirit, in eternity past. Kind of blows our minds to think about it. But he created male and female to be in a perfect relationship with him and with one another, all people. But we know that the fall comes in. In Genesis 3, we're told about sin. Sin enters the world, and this perfect image that humanity is supposed to have is broken. And we feel that brokenness. And one of the clearest ways we feel it is in relationships. We feel the effects of sin and the broken relationships that we have in our lives. And it continues on through the rest of the Bible, even to this day. And we're wondering, is there any hope? Is there any deliverance? Because we all feel that tug inside of us. Gosh, it's supposed to be different. Life isn't supposed to be this way. Is there any hope? And the good news is, yeah, there is. His name's Jesus. You see, Jesus is the Son of God. God himself come down to be one of us, a human. He is God's image. It's everything that God is revealed right there in him. He's the perfect image. Has a perfect relationship with the Father, and he goes around having perfect relationships with people. And the amazing thing is he gets to the end of his life, and he's going to die on the cross. And what happens at the cross is this amazing exchange. Here is the Son of God, the perfect image, and perfect relationships, and he looks at us with our broken image and our broken relationships. He says, how about we trade? I'll take the consequences of all of that brokenness on myself so that you can have all of my perfection. Deal? And he takes the consequences of our brokenness and dies with it on the cross and rises from the grave. He's the redemption. He's the rescue. He's the only hope that we have for an image restored and restored relationships. And that's the story of the rest of the Bible. And that's where we are today. God wants us to experience restoration in our image, who we were meant to be. He wants us to experience restoration in our relationships, how we relate to one another and how we relate to God. And it all begins with faith in Jesus. And that faith that we place in him, it's meant to grow. We're meant to understand it more and live it out better every single day. And I'm convinced of this. From my own experience and from reading the Bible, this is what I'm convinced of. This one line. The most important thing we're going to say tonight is this. All true believers can and will grow in their faith. They can and will grow in their faith through intentional relationships with other committed believers. All true believers can and will grow in their faith through intentional relationships with other committed believers. In fact, this is such an important saying. I think the opposite is true as well, that true believers are not going to grow apart from intentional relationships with other committed believers. I just don't think it's possible. It's not in the Bible. I heard a story one time of a guy who was trying to work his way through seminary as quickly as he could. He wanted to become a pastor and get out there and get to work. And there's this class called, I think, like spiritual formation. He's like, gosh, I've been in the ministry for a while now. I've done some different jobs. I know about my Bible and how to pray. I know about all these things and like how to grow. I bet I could test out of it. So he sets an appointment with a professor and he goes and he sits down with him. He says, hey, I'd like to test out of your class. The professor goes, you know, this is a really important class. We want to make sure that our graduates really understand what it looks like to grow spiritually for their own good and for the people that they'll influence later on in the ministry. He says, yeah, I understand that, but I think I've been there, I've done that, I understand the principles. Can I just test out of your class and be done with it? I think I'm good. He's like, well, let me do this. Let's do an oral exam, one question right now. The guy's like, okay. He says, here's the question. You're all alone, by yourself, you and your Bible, can you grow? Will you grow spiritually? Yes or no? The guy's like, oh man, really it's going to come down to this? He's sitting there thinking. He says, yes. The professor says, the class starts on Monday. See, it's that important. We cannot and we will not grow. It's that important that we have people in our lives. So if it is, if it really is this important, how do we do it? Well, let's get a really clear vision tonight of what that looks like. What does it look like to be in a relationship with other people that's going to help us to grow spiritually, cause us to grow spiritually? And I think one of the best places to look, if there's one paragraph in the entire Bible that sums up the best, I think this is it. In Acts 2, let me give you a little bit of the background. We know that from the Gospels, Jesus lived his life, the perfect life, died on the cross, rose from the grave. Part of his life was training some men to carry on the ministry after him. So that when he leaves and goes back to heaven, these guys basically take over, these followers, these men and women who are following him take over. But they're in Acts 2, they're kind of still scared. And it's not until the Holy Spirit comes in Acts 2 on the day of Pentecost that they become bold. And they leave their locked-in rooms and they go out and they begin to tell people. And there's a man named Peter. Peter stands up in front of the whole entire city of Jerusalem, the very place where Jesus had just been tried and killed, and he preaches the gospel. He even says, you guys are the ones that are responsible for killing him. But there's forgiveness. There's a gracious and merciful God. And he wants you to have eternal life. And the people say, oh my goodness, this is true. And it says that 3,000 people believed that day, were baptized in the church. The very first church was birthed right there in Jerusalem. And this, the very next verse that we're given is this, in verse 42. So follow along on your handout or on the screen. It says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. I love this picture. Now, there's a lot here, and we're just going to unpack it and try to pull out the principles. What do we see here about what this looks like to grow with others? And there's going to be three things I want us to see. If you follow along on the handout, there's going to be a pattern, and that's going to answer the question, you know, what model should we follow here? And we're going to look at the practice. How do we do it? How do we actually engage others and grow spiritually? And then the priority. When and where is this supposed to happen? Let's look at the pattern. Follow along here. If there's any kind of pattern we see, and it's repeated throughout the New Testament, it's this. There's kind of three levels that we see in this passage. There's going to be people who are further along than you. There's going to be people who are right along with you. And there are those who are coming along after you. There's always going to be these three levels that keep showing up. Those further along than you, those right along with you, kind of beside you where you're at, and those coming along after you. And here in the passage, we see it's the apostles. These are the leaders. These are the guys who had just been with Jesus. They heard his voice. They touched him. They ate with him. They followed him for 3 years. They were like him because they'd been around him. They knew what was up. And the response to that gospel message that day is you have all these believers, people who believe and begin to follow Jesus. And the amazing thing, in the city of Jerusalem, other people are beginning to notice. They find this new group, they find it favorable, and they begin coming to faith in Jesus as well. This is the pattern that we see. There's always going to be those people who are further along than us, those who are right there with us, and those coming after us. And so this is what it looks like here in Acts 2. But again, it's throughout the New Testament. Even check this out. In 1 Thessalonians 6 and 7, the Apostle Paul, later on, he writes to some believers in a church in the city of Thessalonica. He says, you also became imitators of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much tribulation with the joy of the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and in Achaia. So here's this group of people. Again, they heard the message from Paul, Silas, and Timothy, the guys that wrote this letter. And these believers in Thessalonica become the examples then for the people of Macedonia and Achaia. Thessalonica is this little city. Macedonia and Achaia, it's like Greece. It's modern Greece. It's this giant region, this whole entire country. This one little group of people becomes the example for the rest to follow. But it's not just big groups. We see it also, it's individual relationships. It's personal smaller groups. In 2 Timothy 2:2, the Apostle Paul writes to his disciple Timothy, he says, the things which you have heard from me, Paul, in the presence of many witnesses, entrust these to faithful people, faithful men and women who will be able to teach others also. So again, you see Paul, Timothy, many witnesses, faithful people able to teach others. Now, I'm kind of a visual person. That was a lot of words. If I was to try to sum it up what this looks like visually, this is kind of how I draw it. You need these three levels. You got you in the middle. And it's going to be really important that the people who are right there with you, you need an inner circle. You need people who are really going to hold you accountable, people who are really close to you. You know them, they know you, you're tight. This is your crew. These are the people you run with. This is the people that got your back. You can call them any time of the day, and they're going to be there for you. But you've got your peers, too. You can't have tight, intimate relationships with everybody, but it helps so much, like in a room like this, to have other people that you know that are about the same thing, that are an encouragement to you, and you can be an encouragement to them. But you also need that layer above you and below you as well. Who are your heroes? Who are your models and your mentors? Who are those who are further along than you that you can learn from? And they don't have to be alive, by the way. Some of these people don't have to. Then who are the younger believers and your unbelieving friends? Who are the people that you are the example to that they can look to you and say, hey, that's what it looks like. That's attractive. I want that, what that person has in my life. This is what it should look like. This is the pattern that we find in the New Testament. Hey, can I share some of my heroes? Is that okay? I'd say, you know, you can borrow mine if you want to. I'd say, get your own. It'd probably be a better idea to get your own. I'll share mine, but let me just share a few of who my heroes are. This is one of them. His name's Howard Hendricks. He passed away in 2013, but he was a seminary professor for over 50 years at Dallas Theological Seminary. Now, it's not the fact he was a seminary professor that impresses me. It's the fact that he was an incredible teacher. I've never heard anyone be able to communicate and teach the way that Prof did. And his legacy, it is massive. The impact that he's had, as I've had the opportunity to take a couple classes at Dallas Theological Seminary, and the impact that he's had even on the current professors, it's amazing to see professors call him Prof. Like everyone there says Prof, and they all know who they're talking about, because there's only one Prof, even though every single one of them are profs. He's an incredible guy, faithful to his wife to the end. He had some incredibly pithy things that made him famous, the way he would talk. He said, most students leave college with both feet firmly planted in midair. He was always trying to get his students moving towards living life on purpose. He said, my greatest fear for you, my students, is not that you would fail, but that you would be successful in the wrong thing. He always had this really clear vision of Jesus and moving people towards a life on purpose, living for Christ. And he called people to it, and he lived it to the end. He's one of my heroes for sure. Here's another one, a couple named Jim and Elizabeth Elliott. Incredible couple. If you haven't heard of them, they were missionaries in Ecuador back in the 1950s. They made contact with a tribe of natives that had never been in touch with Westerners before. And Jim and four of his friends actually gave their lives. They were killed by these people as they were trying to make contact just to share the gospel with them. Incredible story of being a martyr for Christ in a modern era that doesn't happen a lot anymore. And the news, when it came back to the U.S., there were so many people that said, wow, what a waste. What an absolute waste of five perfectly good men, perfectly good lives. But Jim, in his diary, in his journal, wrote this. He said, he is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain that which he cannot lose. What an amazing comment from a man about ready to give the biggest possible sacrifice for the sake of others just to come to know and follow Jesus, who had never heard of him before. He's no fool who gives what he cannot keep, his life, to gain that which he cannot lose, heaven, eternity. What incredible perspective. That's hero material right there. But ladies, you know what? His wife, she's varsity as well. Get this. This is her with their little baby girl who was born right before her father was killed. When the baby was 1 year old, I think a little Victoria, if I remember right, Elizabeth takes her 1-year-old daughter into the jungle to the very same people to share the gospel and plants a church and lives there in the jungle, raises her 1-year-old daughter in the jungle with the people that killed her husband and her friends and plants a church and is still there today. People worshiping and following Jesus to this day. That is hero worthy. Absolutely. Here's one of not just a hero, but a model. This is Dr. Bob. He was a vet professor here at K-State. Him and his wife, Miss Mary. Miss Mary is still here. Dr. Bob passed away, I think 2012. Roughly, we miss him. It was so fun. Every one day every week, I'd get to sit in a room with other guys, kind of the guys who were with me where I was at. And we just get to sit with Dr. Bob and do Bible study together and learn from him. And he just kind of usually sit back in the corner and watch. I think we're more of an encouragement to him, just watching another generation come along and try to be faithful to Christ and influence others and things like that. But he would have these just nuggets of wisdom. And it was so amazing to get to sit because he had lived an incredibly faithful life. He was such an influence, even to Chinese students throughout his entire career. He sold his vet practice just to come be a professor here at K-State, just to be around students and influence them for the sake of the gospel. He's a guy that finished incredibly well and has left an incredible legacy, story after story that we could go into. But just a guy who lived it well. I want to be like that when I'm in my 80s. I want to finish like that with my wife when I'm 80. I want to finish like that with my family when I'm 80. And Dr. Bob's a model for me. Here's a mentor. This is my friend Joel. When we were a little bit younger and both had more hair. And so you might be a little bit mad. No, I don't think you'll be mad if I showed this picture. But we had a ton of fun together. Joel's the best man at my wedding. Joel's the guy that first really shared the gospel with me to help me understand who Jesus was. The first guy to open the Bible with me to understand what the Bible had to say and who God is and who I am and all those things. And I'm so grateful for Joel as a mentor. Even now, we were talking the other day at Dylan's Sunday morning before church. And we're talking about what it looks like to be a dad. He's a great mentor because he's just a little bit further than me, not that much older, but just further down the road. And he's talking about what it's been looking like to raise his couple girls. And I had so much to learn from what he had to say. It was sober. And there are things that I hadn't even thought of yet. And it's so great to have that kind of fellowship, that kind of like-mindedness in my life. I wouldn't give it up for anything. So this is what it looks like. The pattern that we see over and over again. We need those who are further along than you, those who are right there with you, those who are coming along after you. That's the pattern that we need in our lives if we're going to grow. All right, this is such an important point. I want you guys to discuss with your neighbors, the people around you, these couple of questions. I'll give us a couple of minutes, and I'll bring us back together. We'll finish up the last few points.
I love this topic. It's a fun topic to think through and talk about. What does it look like, though, with those people that are around you? What does it actually look like when you get into the practice of what is it like to be in that kind of a group? That's going to cause you to grow, help you to grow. You're going to help them. They're going to help you. What does it actually look like? Let's go back again to the passage, to Acts 2, and let's talk about the practice. We're going to roll through these a little bit quicker. Here we go. The first thing is we see that you got to be devoted to the word, fellowship, food, and prayer. I don't know if you guys ever watched Sesame Street growing up, but they had that little game. It was like one of these things is not like the other. One of these things is not quite the same. You know, does anyone see anything on here that doesn't look like it belongs? Is anyone here excited the fact that food makes the list? Absolutely. I mean, check this out. Verse 42, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, and so that would be the word of God because the apostles are teaching the word of God, and they're obviously committed to growing because teaching and learning is a growth opportunity. They developed a fellowship, being together with one another, the breaking of bread, and the prayer. Now, it seems like three of those things are really spiritual, and the fourth one is just food. Now, maybe that was the thing that like got people to come. I don't know. Put the donuts in the back, something like that. I don't know. But I'm really excited that there's food on there. I think that's an amazing thing. But when you think about the fact that if we're going to have people around us, it's going to help us to grow, we need these four things. And it really feels funny to say that because I want to say, well, you definitely need those three. But man, they included that one in there. But we definitely need the Word of God. Sims did a great job last week talking about that. We're going to talk about prayer later on in the semester. But man, fellowship. Who is going to be those people that you're going to share life with? That word fellowship, it just means to have in common. What are you going to share? What are you going to have in common with people? And really the thing that we have most in common is Jesus. That's what makes this fellowship work. All right, number two. These people, they're sharing resources to meet real needs. This is what we need to do. We need to be sharing resources to meet real needs. Again, back the text. Verse 44 says, all the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Now, it's really important here because with this phrase, they had everything in common, we could easily misunderstand that with our modern ears. And when we hear, oh, these people have everything in common, we think, oh, they're just alike. Whether it's like an ethnic group or a cultural group or a campus group or a major or everyone's just the same in this hall or this fraternity or something like that. That's not at all what this means. It means, again, that they have everything in common when it comes to their faith that actually breaks down all of those barriers. One of my favorite examples of this is this guy right here. He's a friend that I had in grad school. His name is Amin Aknuk. Isn't that an awesome name? He's from Egypt. And Amin Aknuk, Amin is of the descendants of the original Egyptians that go all the way back to Bible times, like the people of the pharaohs. You can kind of hear that like almost like pharaoh name, Aknuk, you know, it's an awesome thing. Amin was incredible. The history is probably too much to go into here, but Amin's people are the Coptic Christians of Egypt. They make up roughly about 10% of Egypt, and they're definitely in the minority. Egypt is 90% Muslim, and this 10% minority Christian group is basically famous for how badly they're persecuted over and over and over again. Amin's faith was incredible. So I'm in grad school, it's civil engineering, a lot of early mornings, a lot of late nights, a lot of math that I didn't even understand, but somehow I made it through, you know, lots of prayer. And I would get so, like, anxious and so frustrated. I remember one day, I was just like, I don't know how to get this done, I don't know how to get this done. I was just completely stressing out. And Amin goes, "Oh, Bob, have you not prayed to Jesus about this?" I look at him like, I'm looking at him right now, I'm like, "Amin, are you serious?" It's like, "No, I guess I haven't." It's like, "Oh, Bob, Jesus will hear your prayers. He will help you. There's no need to worry." It's like, "Thank you, Amin. I needed that." One day he had these like pictures pulled up on his computer from back home, and there were some recent some bombings and things that had happened in churches in Egypt. It happens, unfortunately, kind of frequently, and unfortunately, Amin knows a lot of these people. And he was just so upset, and it was kind of my turn to play the comforter and try to like step into his world and understand. And I was having a really hard time, but all of a sudden, I'll never forget, he just got, just puffed out his chest and just was so passionate. He said, "You know, Bob, they can kill me for Jesus if they want to." It's like, "Wow, okay." He's like, "You know what?" And he reaches down to his shirt and he pulls out this cross necklace. He's like, "They could kill me for this, and it would be worth it because of Jesus." It's like, I feel JV right now, okay? And then he does the most amazing thing. He reaches, like, his whole hand down his shirt. It's, like, kind of awkward, like, can you imagine? And he pulls out, I'm not even kidding, this, like 6-7-inch metal cross. This thing was huge. I'm like, "Did you have that on the whole time?" You know, that was the first thought that went through my head. And he goes, "And Bob, they can kill me for this one." I was like, "Or you could probably kill him back." I mean, this thing was massive. Amin's faith was incredible. He was so much further along. We had very little in common. Very little in common growing up. I grew up in a small town, white kid, suburbia near Kansas City. That, I mean, riding bikes in the cul-de-sac. That was me. Amin grew up on the mean streets of Egypt, where his church was potentially going to be bombed again. We don't have a whole lot in common, except Jesus. He was an amazing brother in Christ for those couple of years we were together in grad school. See, when it comes to this idea, these people, they had possessions, they had means, and they would do whatever they could to help another out. And hey, college students, I understand. There's not a lot of like liquid assets that you can get rid of, right? But I mean, we all have something to give. And I think that's probably the most important thing when it comes to this idea of fellowship in the inner circle. You gotta show up, not just so what you can give, what you can get, but because of what you can give. You see, when you don't show up, someone's missing out from what you can uniquely contribute. And that's what these people understood. That's why they're so quick to give their things away. I guarantee every single one of us has a strength, has a gift, has something from God that's going to bless someone else. And God wants us to give it away. All right, number three here. They were meeting together in person, face to face. They're meeting together in person, face to face. It's kind of obvious, but in verse 46, every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes, talking about food again. They ate together. And it was so important for them to be together, face to face. I probably wouldn't normally put this point in here because it's so obvious, but I think there's a real danger in our culture today. There's so much technology, and we can be so connected at a distance that sometimes we miss what it looks like to have an authentic relationship together, face to face with people. Who are those people that you're going to commit to being your inner circle and being with them and doing life with them eyeball to eyeball? Because there's some things you just can't get across on a screen. And we know that, and we long for that, but too often we shy away from it. I'm right there with you, but we've got to press into it. All right, number four, experiencing joy and authenticity. This is the last part of the practice here, experiencing joy and authenticity. I love what it says. It says they're together with glad and sincere hearts. Glad and sincere hearts. A lot of times we don't think about gladness or joy going with sincerity, but when you're sincere, when you're being authentic, man, it produces the opportunity to actually be real with people. And what does it mean to have a sincere heart? What does that look like? If we keep going through the New Testament, we find this amazing phrase that comes up over and over again. It's just the one another. The Bible over and over again in the New Testament tells us to do different things to one another, to one another, to one another, to one another. And I pulled a few out here. Look at this. Imagine having a group of friends that you're going to grow in your faith with that this would be true of, that they would do this for you and you would do this for them. And think about what the response would be like in your heart, in your mind, in your soul, if this was true of your group. If you guys admonished one another, if you bear one another's burdens, if you care for one another, if you have compassion one for another, if you confess your faults one to another, if you forgive one another, if you are kind to one another, if you had peace with one another, if you pray for one another, if you restore one another, what kind of joy and authenticity would you have? If you serve one another, if you do not envy one another, if you do not lie to one another, if you do not speak evil of one another, if you actually love one another. And this is just a sample. It goes on and on and on. There's so many more. But even from this, you can begin to see, man, this is why people are coming to Jesus day by day. This is why God was using this group. Think about the joy and the authenticity, even that our world today longs for. Think about how many people are miserable. Think about how many people are depressed and just full of anxiety and desperate for joy and gladness in their life. Think about how many people at the same time crave sincere people, crave authenticity. We have the opportunity to practice it in Christ. And I don't think it would be possible apart from God's help. That's what it's going to look like to practice this growing with others. I mean, true joy and authenticity. But let's talk about the priority. Last thing here, we've got the pattern, we got the practice, the priority. Let me just give them both to you right now. Daily and continually, that's when they met, and they're public and private. Daily and continually, public and private. Every day in verse 46, they continued to meet together in the temple courts, and they broke bread in their homes and ate together every day and continually. They made a practice of it. This is what they did, and they didn't back down from it. And they did it in the temple courts. I wish you guys could understand just how public of a venue that was. That was literally the centerpiece of the entire city. Everybody went there. And they did it in public. They did it in private. They went to their own homes. And they got intimate with one another. They knew each other. They knew each other's families. They got to know each other. They did this in public. They did this in private. What an incredible priority. It didn't matter when or where. They were going to get this done. I think about this group of guys, the group of guys I got to do some life with a handful of years ago. One of my favorite things about this group is their schedules were so bad at meshing. The only time that we could get together for, like, read the Bible, pray, learn and grow together, encourage one another, all that stuff, was 5:30 in the morning on Fridays. None of us wanted 5:30 on Fridays to be the only time we could meet together. 5:30 in the morning on Fridays for 2 hours was the only time we could meet together. A lot of them had 8 o'clock class on Friday mornings. But it was amazing to watch that year. We even thought, hey, the spring is going to get better. It didn't get better. It was amazing to watch what God did over the course of that year and how much this group grew together to really form a bond of brotherhood with one another. And to watch them just grow and mature in their faith, it was incredible. Three of these guys are serving overseas right now. Two of them in a pretty hard place where a lot of people just do not know Christ at all, but they're giving their lives away there. Another one of them is doing an incredible job of being active in his church in Olathe, back in the Kansas City area, and God's using them there. And it's amazing. I don't think that when they came into college, that's where they thought they would end up. But it's because of this group that they begin to really truly grow because they made it that kind of priority. It didn't matter because they wanted to have that kind of community, that kind of fellowship with one another. So here again, the main point tonight, all true believers can and will grow in their faith through intentional relationships with other committed believers. We have to believe that. And just to illustrate it further, I want to invite Tanner up here. He's going to be a real flesh and blood example of what this has looked like, even for him, as he's been in college. So welcome up, Tanner.
So kind of fellowship has played a huge role for me throughout my college career, but kind of in high school, I was the kind of guy that I went to church regularly, but I was the kind of guy that like I would answer in the lull of conversation was when like the youth pastor was trying to stump you, but in reality, I was like reading out of my study Bible to try and flex on people. That was just kind of me, that was who I was about, but I really was living a super hypocritical life. Like I had this false image of like this Christian guy, but I would come home and I'd be with guys on the weekend and be just a completely different guy, but towards the tail end of my senior year, I put my trust in Christ. And so kind of coming into college, I really knew what I wanted to be about. And so I joined a fraternity and I really looked for guys that I wanted to, you know, run alongside. And there were three guys, there are three types of guys that I really admired based on what I saw from him. And the first guy, I knew that he was a Christian. I knew he was definitely about it. I knew he read his Bible and not only read it, but did what it said. And he was just around everyone all the time. Like he was at all the parties, he was at all the fraternity events, he was at all the basketball games and doing whatever with everyone. And that was kind of a paradigm shift for me because I was like, man, I'm going to come into college and I am going to lock arms with other believers and just form like this holy huddle. And we're going to read our Bibles on Friday nights and pray and not do anything else with anyone. But these guys were like really living to make an impact. You know, they were getting to know guys on a genuine level that didn't know God and ask intentional questions. The next guy was a guy who was an older guy, and I really looked up to him a ton. I would ask him a lot of questions. You know, I was kind of new in my faith. I went to him for advice, and he would give me his opinion a lot of times, but it was his opinion, but he always backed it up with scripture from his memory, from, you know, the Bible. And that was like crazy to me. I'm like, wow, this guy like knows the Bible to the point where he's like memorizing it. So I remember one time like over break, I was like, I kind of want to do this for myself. So I shot him a text. I was like, hey, can you send me like the list where you got started? I really want to look into doing this for myself, because he was challenging me a ton. And I still talk with him to this day and still get advice from him. About, you know, different things and different struggles that I go through now. And the third guy is kind of a guy that I was running alongside, growing alongside early on in college. And I can remember so many conversations when we're just walking to class, doing whatever, and he stops me and says, hey, Tanner, I got a sin to confess to you. I really was struggling in an area last night, and I kind of slipped up a little bit. And I was like, I remember hearing that for the first couple of times. I was like, man, this is crazy. I've never been this vulnerable with anyone. And this guy is willing to do it with me because he has such a conviction that he's willing to, you know, tell me about his sin. And I began to do the same thing with him. I remember just a little while ago, I was struggling one night just because of a certain sin area. And I broke down in my room, and he was the first guy I called. I was like, man, I'm struggling right now. Can you come say what's up? And we just kind of had a moment. And yeah, it was super like super crazy, and I it's crazy to think back to these guys, these guys that I've become that I started to grow alongside, because coming into college, one of my best friends from high school, we were kind of like at the same spot as far as, you know, faith interest goes. We both kind of wanted to look into faith, but we surrounded ourselves with two different groups of people. He surrounded himself with some guys that maybe weren't such good influences on him, and that really cost him in the end, because he let them influence him to a point where now he's really not even looking into his faith. He's really just living out the stereotypical college life, and he's really, I can see he's just kind of left broken and still looking for something that's going to satisfy him and fulfill him. And I'm still good friends with him, don't get me wrong. I hang out with him all the time. I'm still friends with a lot of guys that don't know God, but really the people who I let influence me, the people who I care about, like their opinions, are the guys that I know are going to challenge me and are going to really set my bar. higher. And so, a verse that really kind of inspires me is Hebrews 10, 24 and 25. And it says, "Let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." That's kind of what fellowship has looked like for me. And I'll just toss it back up to Bob and let him close us out.
Awesome, guys. Well, hey, there you have it. Hopefully that tonight, just looking at Acts 2, thinking through these things, gives you a clearer picture of what it's going to look like to grow with others. Now, as we look at that, we're probably going to realize, hey, that's an incredible ideal. I don't know that I'm there. There's probably going to be some things, some adjustments to make, some tweaks in our relationship, some different things we're going to need to adjust in our walk with God if this is where we're going to be when it comes to walking with God with others and growing with others. And so what I want us to do is I want us to spend some time even just talking with the people around us, these last couple questions, just so we can continue to think through, hey, what are some good next steps? We don't have to get it all figured out tonight, but what would be some things even this next week that we could begin to do to make sure that we have the right people around us so we can have stories like Tanner's as we wrap up even our time in college. So go ahead and talk through these other couple things, and we'll pull back together here in a minute.